So I have to admit, I'm not an expert on DIY anamorphic lenses, on vintage lenses, or even anamorphic lenses for that matter. And I don't really know how to handle anamorphic footage in post. But as you've seen from the past few videos on my channel, I decided to take the plunge into the abyss and figure out exactly what equipment you need in order to make a DIY anamorphic setup for your camera. So if you've been on the fence about doing a project like this, or if you're just stumbling on this video in the YouTube rabbit hole, this video will help you gain the knowledge to at least figure out how to do it, how much a DIY anamorphic lens could cost, and will hopefully show kind of what the limitations are when you do something like this. This video could be a long one, I'm not really sure. We'll see. So if it is, let's get into it. My name's Dustin, your video tour guide, and please keep your arms and legs inside your chairs at all times. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the video. Just a reminder that I do live streams on the YouTube channel, but to keep it from getting oversaturated with live streams, I stream on Twitch as well. So if you have questions or feel like I missed something or just want to chat, feel free to come pop into my Twitch chat. As of lately, I've been kind of bad at streaming, but give me a break. It's been my anniversary. I'm building a house. I've got side projects. I've got my full-time job. I got a lot going on, okay? I will try to be better, but there is a link down in the description. Okay, so what I'm going to do with this video is I'm going to break up the different pieces of the build and go over what you need, first of all, in order to make a setup like this work. Items that will make your life easier but aren't necessary, and things that are what I'd call a luxury. There are advantages and disadvantages to basically all the different pieces when you're doing a DIY build like this, and I'm going to cover everything that I learned. I'm also going to be covering different brands of items here you can purchase and hopefully cover what the advantages and disadvantages are as well. I've also included in the description everything I used in this setup and the website on where you can get them. I'm also going to link a few groups and YouTube channels that have a ton of resources and education if you are confused, need to do more research, or have some questions on how to do something like this. So the first thing you need in order to create an anamorphic lens is two things. A taking lens, which in this case is the Helios 442 58mm f2, and an anamorphic lens in the front, which in this case is the Koa B&H 2x. There are some things you need to be aware of when choosing a taking lens, and this is where you may have to do some of your own research in case you run into things I don't cover. More than likely, you're going to have to choose a taking lens that is at least 50mm. The reason for this is once you add the anamorphic lens, if you have anything lower than 50mm, you're going to get vignetting. Keep in mind as well that I am also shooting at 4x3, which helps with the vignetting since I'm using less width on the sensor and more height. Plus, I'm also at Super 35 on my Panasonic S1H. So once you factor in everything with this setup, it's technically an 87mm lens, but there is something with anamorphic lenses that happens to your shot depending on your squeeze factor. Even though I'm at 87mm, my anamorphic front, the Koa B&H, is a 2x squeeze, and once you de-squeeze that in post, you're getting the look of an 87mm lens, obviously, but you're also getting the look of about a 44mm lens because of how wide the field of view is. You following me? Basically, what anamorphic lenses do is they capture a wider field of view than the standard spherical lenses, and then they squish that field of view into the same area on the sensor as a spherical lens would, which is where that iconic wide aspect ratio comes from in cinema. Hopefully that all made sense and that I explained it correctly. Now, when it comes to choosing a taking lens, you can essentially use any lens that's 50mm. Just to give you an example, here's a shot using my Sigma 50mm as the taking lens. The biggest reason to use these older vintage lenses is because of their size. Like the Helios, look at this, it's tiny. And also I just bought this lens, which is the Canon FD 50mm 1.4, and because of their price. The Helios is about 90 bucks on eBay, and the Canon FD is a similar price, whereas if I used my Sigma, that's like a $900 taking lens roughly. Using the Sigma 2 makes it a little bit difficult just because of the build of the lens being a lot bigger. And you're most likely going to have to use a clamp of some sort to put the anamorphic lens in the front, which I'll talk about in a minute. The reason you would want to use the Sigma though is the Helios is a little soft for my taste, and it also creates some crazy swirly bokeh that's really cool but can sometimes be a little too much when you pair it with the anamorphic lens. This is the reason I bought the 50mm Canon FD, because I get the size of the Helios, but it's a much sharper lens and it'll give me a different look when it comes to the setup. This is where a DIY anamorphic lens gets super fun. You can change out the taking lens and the anamorphic lens to essentially whatever you want. If you wanted to take the Helios and get another anamorphic front that's maybe like a 1.8 times squeeze, you could do that. There's a ton of different anamorphic fronts out there, and I'm not going to cover everything, but the main takeaway from this when you're choosing a taking lens or an anamorphic front is to do a lot of research about the lens, and if you're buying it on eBay, ask a lot of questions, take a look at a lot of the pictures of the lens, and make sure you're getting what you want. There's a ton of different options out there, and like I said, this is where you're going to have to figure out what you want. Oh, and lastly, I forgot to mention price. I mentioned a few things like the Helios lens that is about 90 bucks on eBay, and my Koa B&H was about 860 bucks. Keep in mind, you don't have to buy an anamorphic lens that costs that much. There are anamorphic lenses out there that cost anywhere from 100 bucks and more. It just depends on how rare they are and the condition of the lenses. Like I said, just do some research and figure out what you want and what you can afford. Besides the taking lens and the anamorphic lens, there's two more things you will need to complete the essential items to your DIY anamorphic setup. Depending on your taking lens, you'll need an adapter, and depending on the anamorphic lens, you'll need either some step-up rings or a lens clamp. For this setup, you would need an M42 mount to L-mount adapter. These are pretty easy to find, not just on like camera websites, but on websites like Amazon, and they are very affordable. I'm pretty sure my adapter I got on Amazon for like 15 bucks. And if I wanted to make this setup work, I can also use a step-up ring to connect my taking lens to the anamorphic. Some anamorphic lenses out there though either don't have threads, or if I wanted to use my Sigma lens as the taking lens, I would have to use some kind of clamp kind of mounted on rails to put the anamorphic lens in front of the Sigma. As far as the price on clamps, I use the one from Rapido Technology, which is 130 bucks. But I'm sure there are some more affordable options out there. As of right now, I don't have any recommendations for you, but maybe check out some of the resources I linked in the description to see if they have some recommendations. So to build your own anamorphic lens, you're probably going to have to spend at least roughly $300 to $400. Remember, this is kind of just the minimum if you want to make something like this work. I realize there are ways to get kind of an anamorphic look by using filters and stuff like that, but I'm only covering how to do it like this. There are some big disadvantages to doing a setup like this though. The biggest being double focus. I talked about this a bit in my previous video, but with having two lenses, you have to match the focus on both lenses in order to keep things in focus. So you're super limited in what you can do with this setup. The other disadvantage is the focus distance. I don't know what the exact focus distance is with this setup, but it's probably about 3 feet, which is pretty far away. So if you want anything closer than 3 feet, you're kind of stuck. Let's move on to the items that will make your life easier, because if you're going to use a setup like this for like professional work, you're probably going to want to consider this stuff. The first item on the list is diopters. The reason I put these first on the list is because they're cheap. You can get a set of diopters for 15 to 30 bucks. These I have here are from Amazon, and I paid $25 for them. If you don't know what diopters do, they just make it so you can focus closer on something. Remember the minimum focus distance I talked about? You can fix this by throwing on a +1 diopter on the front, and boom, you can now get those close-up shots you wanted. The only disadvantage to diopters is you won't be able to focus to infinity. Most of the time, I probably won't ever need to do a rack like that, but just keep that in mind when you're using them. The next on the list is a single focus solution. Like I said, this isn't a must, but it'll really simplify things if you plan to use a setup like this in professional work. The one I'm using is the Rapido FVD-16A, and it cost $580. Yes, it's pretty pricey, but there's a reason I chose this one, and it's not because of the housing I used, which I'll cover later. Some of the other single focus solutions out there is the SLR Magic rangefinder. It's a much more affordable option at $250, but the biggest reason I didn't choose that one is because if you plan to use a focus wheel, be aware that when you focus, the gear moves forward, kind of making it not possible to use a focus wheel. I haven't tried it with one, but I'm pretty sure it will make it difficult to use. The next option is the Rectilux Hardcore DNA. Honestly, I'm not sure the price on this because the website is kind of confusing, and I learned you have to reach out directly to the one building it. And last I heard, it's a ways out if you wanted to get your hands on one. I'm not sure where things are at right now, but personally, I think the Rapido is the best option. Rapido also has a bigger option called the FVD-35A in case with your setup you run into vignetting, but it will cost $1,200. And keep in mind, the thread in the front is 115 millimeters, whereas with the FVD-16A, it's 77 millimeters. So as far as diopters go, you may be spending a little more to find something, if they even exist, to pair it with the FVD-35A. And I don't know if they exist because I didn't check. Again, with single focus solutions, do some research and see what would be best for you. There seems to be other options out there that I didn't cover. I just felt like these were the best options if you can get your hands on one, depending on which you choose. As far as things that will make your life easier, that's it. So let's move on to the luxury items. Really, the luxury item here is what's called the full metal jacket from Rapido. Like I mentioned in the previous video, this kind of setup looks kind of janky, and some people might appreciate a setup like this, but the cosmetic upgrade just makes the setup look so cool. The full metal jacket cost about $420, and there are some disadvantages to this setup. The biggest is availability. There is only certain taking lenses and anamorphic lenses that Rapido makes a full metal jacket for. As far as taking lenses, the Helios 44-2 was on the list, as well as the Koa B&H. There is a decent amount of options, but it will restrict your build if you are wanting to use lenses not listed on the site. Another disadvantage is it makes it so you can't see what your f-stop is. So for the video I shot with this setup, all I did was make the decision I want it to be a shallower depth of field or a wider depth of field based on what I saw in the monitor. And another thing, which is preventable, I have now learned, which makes me sad, and that is bite marks. In order to assemble this, you have to use screws to secure the anamorphic lens properly, and those screws create bite marks. If you're going to do this and don't want bite marks, I recommend picking up some different screws that have a little rubber on the end, so you're not screwing tightly into your anamorphic lens unless you just don't care. I didn't care too much about the Helios, but I am a little sad about my Koa B&H, so you're welcome. So all in all, cost-wise for my setup, remember, you can be cheaper than this. It was $90 for the Helios, $860 for the Koa B&H, and I bought the Rapido FVD-16A and the full metal jacket in a package for $1,000, which means this was about $2,000 for this setup. Now you might be thinking, wow, you could have just bought a really nice lens instead of this. But when you think about it, in comparison to an Atlas anamorphic lens, it's not a bad price. An Atlas, for comparison, is the cheapest 2x anamorphic lens I could find, and it's $8,000. It's also way bigger and has the same focus distance at 3 feet. I get the advantages too, going with an Atlas or a legit anamorphic lens, but at the end of the day, not comparing costs and everything, I personally think, at least for now, this is more fun. I can see dealing with this for years could get annoying, but if you're like me and you're looking for a way to break into the anamorphic market and you want to do something challenging and just fun, then this could be for you. The biggest advice I can give you is to make sure you do lots of research. Just reminding you, I put links to all the resources I use to help me make a setup like this possible. So if you're confused or have more questions, I definitely recommend checking out those resources. I've also linked everything I use in this build in the description, so if you want to build this exact setup, check out those links. If you found this video helpful, be sure to give it a triple thumbs up. And if you want to support what I do, be sure to check out everything else in the description because it helps make these videos possible. If you want to get to know me more or have more questions, again, feel free to come pop into my Twitch chat or join my Discord channel. We already have a small community growing there and it's awesome. You can also support the channel by hitting the subscribe button and the bell button to be notified of future uploads. Until that time though, happy filming.